So yesterday in class, we talked a little bit about what the internet is. It's not Facebook, it's not Google, it's not Twitter. It's the routers and the switches that make up the communications infrastructure. So let's talk a little bit more today about what that means and how it's organized. And we'll also look at some of the applications of the internet, including email, SSH, and of course the World Wide Web being the most prominent example. We'll take a little bit of a look at how the World Wide Web works behind the scenes and show you how you can play around with it yourself. Let's get started. Now, I'd like to show you a picture of what the internet looks like, and rather than draw one, I'll use the internet to look one up. When you go to Google, you can click on this link Images and do a Google image search. Let's search for the internet. And you can see a variety of pictures coming up. Usually when I think of the internet, I think of one of these constellation pictures. In fact, here's a picture from Wikipedia, and if I just view that image, you can see that it looks like a constellation of the universe. Basically, what you have in this picture is each one of these little dots, let me zoom into this region right here, represents a computer connected to the internet. And computers are connected to other computers, which are connected to routers and switches, and ultimately the backbone of the internet itself. The more densely connected things are in this picture, the darker the color. So the different shaded regions show you perhaps spanning different countries or going across different internet service providers. I'm going to change my image search to internet service provider to give you something that's more of what you find in the book. So here's an image that's similar to figure 4.7, where you have the internet consisting of tier 1 providers, or at least in this figure it says tier 3. Let me see if I can find a better one. Yeah, tier 1 ISPs and tier 2 networks, which are mentioned in the book. And ultimately, all of us with our phones, laptops, and desktops are down here in this internet users portion of the picture here. We connect to our tier 3 networks, such as Comcast or Verizon or Intelus. And they connect into larger networks that are owned by different communications companies across the country. Those end up being the Tier 2 networks and the Tier 3 networks. These little blue symbols all across the picture are routers, right? And so they're not even, typically a router could be a computer or it can be specialized hardware, but its sole purpose is basically to take bits or packets and transfer them from one end of the router to the appropriate other end, depending on where the destination of the packet is going. Now, as I mentioned before, as we looked at the constellation picture, each one of the computers on the internet has an IP address. IP stands for Internet Protocol. It's the address that says this is where a packet is going to, or the address where a packet is coming from. Let's take a look at an IP address example. Here's some. Now, most of the computers are still using IP version 4, which is a 32-bit address. You can see here 32 ones and zeros that represent the address of a computer. Now, just like we learned to write hexadecimal to reduce the number of zeros and ones a person has to look at, there's another way to organize these binary digits in what's called dotted decimal notation. If we take each 8 bits and turn it into a decimal number, like 172, 16, and so forth, then we have 4 decimal numbers. The decimal numbers range from 0 to 255, because that's how many different numbers you can represent with 8 bits. 256, or 2 to the 8th power. So basically, this is a typical IP address, 4 decimal numbers separated by dots, which makes up 32 bits. Let's take a look at what the IP address of my machine is. I'm going to hit Control Plus a couple times to make the font bigger. Now, on Linux or Mac, the command to see your IP address is ifconfig. This means interface config for network interface. And you'll see a variety of different things output. So one is my internet address, and this happens to be the address of my desktop at work. And also a hardware address, which is a series of hexadecimal digits that encodes the serial number of my network card. Pretty much every network interface in any device has a unique hardware address. I also see an Internet version 6 address, which is a 128-bit address, and that's beyond the scope of this class. But the Internet is running out of addresses, so we're moving to a new version of IP that allows you more bits to uniquely identify each device. I also know how many packets I've received and how many packets I've transmitted and so forth. Now, as we know, human beings aren't very good at remembering large numbers or large groups of numbers. Instead, we'd like to refer to a computer by name, such as going into a web browser and typing in the address google.com. Well, google.com has an IP address, just like anything else, and if you want to see the IP address of a particular site, you can use the host command, host google.com, and this gives me the different set of addresses that google.com has. Google is such a large service that it needs to have many IP addresses to balance the load across all of its different users. But I could have just as well taken this IP address, copy it, and paste it into my web browser. And it works the same way whether I use the name or the IP address directly. Let's do another one. Host jmu.edu. So jmu.edu only has one IP address, because it's not quite so big as Google. This process of converting a domain name like jmu.edu to an IP address like 134.126.10.50 is called domain name system. You can read about it, for example, on Wikipedia or in your book, and the basic idea is you send a request to a domain name server that will tell you, oh, I know the address of google.com. It is 216.12.120.57. The host command actually connects to a domain name server to get you the IP address of a host name. There's other things you can do with DNS. For example, I can run the whois command, and whois will get me the registration information for that domain. So, for example, the registrant of jmu.edu is James Madison University. Here's the address. Here's the contact person and their phone number and their email address and so forth. Let's see who owns google.com. Who is google.com? And the output's a lot longer. Here you can contact with an address or a phone number or a fax, if you're back in the 80s, I guess, and a bunch of other information. So basically, any website that's registered has to have some of this information, like a contact person or an address or somebody to complain to if the site is misbehaving, for example. Again, that's the whois command to see who a site is. Let's do yahoo.com. Or you can use the host command to actually get the IP address of the host. These are different commands that allow you to interact with the domain name system.